Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I apologize in advance for my voice, my throat. This is day three of three-day recordings. So the last 2 weeks of episodes have been done the same week, which, you know, was not a great idea. But, you know, I had to get the guests in. And I've got an absolutely amazing guest for you this week. It's the superior Cypriot. It's God's gift to wrestling himself. It's Theo Doros. Welcome to the show.
Thanks, Billy. Thanks for having me on. It's good to be on.
I'm very excited. I think I saw you wrestling way back in, the Dundee days when you popped up there. So it's nice to actually get a chat with you at some point. And like I was saying, off recording, you've fairly packed in a lot of adventures and moments and matches that we're going to try and get into at some point over this next wee while. But the first question is always the same for new guests. It's the bog standard question a wrestler gets asked. What got you to pro wrestling? What was the moment that you watched that got you hooked into it?
It was a promo of The Rock. It was him and Stone Cold in the ring. The Rock was on the mic. I think it was in the lead up to their match at WrestleMania 19. Okay. And ever since then, just the charisma those two guys had. As soon as I saw him, I thought The Rock was the coolest guy in the world. And then for me, that was it. I just fell in love with it right from there.
So that would be Hollywood Rock then that really kind of dragged you in. It wasn't a Attitude Era time. It was, 2003, I'm guessing that would have been WrestleMania 19. So that's a pretty different time for other people's The Rock moments coming into Hollywood. So at that time, man, the roster as well, you'd have had likes of Kurt Angle, Brock Lesnar, all these kind of good wrestling guys. It's underrated period of time, I think, anyway. So was The Rock your first proper favorite wrestler then?
100%, yeah. As soon as I saw The Rock, as soon as I saw that promo, I just fell in love with him. And ever since then, I would go back and watch all his stuff. I would just watch promos, matches, just everything on The Rock in between the shows you got in Cyprus. Obviously, growing up in Cyprus, we got everything on almost a 2 month delay. I just sort of fell in love with it and just went back, watched all his stuff and everything. It was just great, absolutely great.
So growing up in Cyprus, then you say it was a two month delay. That's quite wild to think. I mean, in the UK, we were maybe like a week, if that, unless it was WCW, or we'd have to rely on the magazines if you didn't have Sky or anything like that. So was it on like terrestrial television, or did you have to have the Cypriot equivalent of cable, or how did you access all this content?
It was on the Cypriot version of cable. Yeah, so it was on a TV program called Alpha TV, I think it was. And it would just be on every Thursday, but they would always mess about the times. So I would always call up every Thursday to find out what time the wrestling would be on. And the woman eventually knew who I was, and she would wait for my call every Thursday to see what time. Because we didn't even have like TV guide or anything in Cyprus back then. It was all through the magazine. And if you didn't get the magazine, then you had to call up to see what time stuff was on.
Yeah, that's definitely a stark contrast to what it is now, where you could just Google everything and that's it, done. 2003 some people still would have been dial-up. I think I was still dial-up around about then, absolutely. So how did you get, growing up in Cyprus then, and you started wrestling in Livingston. So how did that happen?
Well, I grew up in Cyprus. But I moved over to Scotland in 2009, I think it was, 2009. And then I obviously that would take me, finished high school and then went to university here. And then that's essentially, I got back into wrestling roughly around WrestleMania 28 time. And then I just fell back in love with it after seeing Triple H, Undertaker, Hell in a Cell, and Rock Cena. Those were the two matches that got me to watch WrestleMania 28 with my friends. And then I just fell straight back in love with wrestling and just started watching it again and became a fan all over again.
The Rock would have been well gone by that. Oh, no, 28. That would have been, was it
That was his comeback match against Cena.
Yeah, it was. What was it called again? It wasn't because Once in a Lifetime. That was it. Once in a Lifetime was him and Cena. So The Rock first got you into it, and then The Rock kind of brought you back in as well, along with the Hell in the Cell as well. So definitely, The Rock is quite integral to your wrestling fandom quite clearly. So was it just a family move that was just over to Scotland and for work or that? Because you said you're in high school, so clearly, I guess you weren't the facilitator to go, right, we're going to Scotland.
No, it was just a family move. Just a family move. When my mum and dad separated, my mum being Scottish, my mum moved over here. And I just assumed there would be more opportunities in terms of university, further life and stuff over here. So I moved over with my mum.
So you had to give up the weather to go for your opportunities, your prospects instead. So that seems like a fair trade, I suppose. We get one day a year that's maybe sunny instead. So how did you get into Reckless Intent then? So that's 2009, you moved here. I've got here your debut is 2015. So I'm going to guess you had a year or two at least to train. So how did you find out about Reckless?
So I didn't actually have a year or two to train. I think I only trained for about 2 months before debuting in 2015. I was in a chip shop one night and I saw a flyer for one of their upcoming shows. So I started following them on Facebook. And I just had a wee bit of an interest in them. And then I was, I just thought one night, I'm going to try going along to training. So I went along to training, tried it, and instantly fell in love with it. I seemed to pick it up quite quickly. And then I was there 3-4 times a week, every single training session I could. I was there, try to just become as good as I could, as quick as I could. Because I just wanted to wrestle. As soon as I was at that first training session, I enjoyed the first training session that much. And I thought, great, I want, if the training is this enjoyable, if the training is this good, I cannot wait to do it in front of an audience.
2 months. Wow. Okay. Right. So the Superior Cypriot, the God's Gift thing, it's not just a moniker that you can put in there. If they felt you were ready to go 2 months in, to get in the ring, did you feel like you were ready when you were given the AOK to perform in front of a crowd?
At the time, I felt I was ready. Looking back on it now, I think I was ready. I was able to perform adequately. Could I have, if I'd obviously trained for a bit longer, would my first few matches have been better? Of course. But again, I'm very much, I love learning on the job. I just love diving headfirst into things. Sink or swim. And thankfully, I swam. And here we are. I feel like I was ready at the time. I went on, I did myself proud. I did my trainers proud. And that's all I can really ask for.
So when it came when you were training, did you have, I'm assuming you had a sport background, because I don't want to absolutely just gush about you, but you looked like a wrestler, as in you're in good shape. You said you look like a wrestler. So did you have a sport background that had you kind of prepared before you took that first bump, or was it just luck?
I play a lot of sport. I still actively play football, both 11-a-side and 5-a-side. I was training in the gym for a good 3-4 years before starting wrestling. Myself, I'm a qualified sports scientist, a qualified nutritionist, qualified strength and conditioning coach as well. So I'm a very athletic person. I tend to be okay at all sports I play in, because naturally I am just quite athletic and sport's always been a big part of my life. So yeah, it was just one of those ones where I stepped in, and I'm being quite athletic as it was, I was able to pick things up quite quickly.
I was looking through your first year of wrestling, or at least 2015, and there was two matches that kind of caught my eye straight away. One was against Demo in 2015, because you know it's Demo. That's quite a big deal. So that was in Dundee, in Mingus Hill Community Centre. I think that's how it's pronounced. So that's quite a big match, really early on. Were you aware of Damo's reputation? Are you aware of his standing in Scottish wrestling? Were you aware of Scottish wrestling in general outside of Reckless Intent when you're coming into that match?
Yeah, I was. I knew Damo was one of the biggest names in Scottish wrestling. I knew he was one of the best in Scottish wrestling at the time. Before starting with Reckless Intent, I wasn't too aware of much of Scottish wrestling outside of Reckless Intent and ICW. And Discovery, obviously, who Reckless had a relationship with. So they were the only three companies I really knew. But I, as soon as I entered the world of wrestling, I didn't want to be almost like new to it all. I didn't want to not know what was going on. So I made sure to learn about the different wrestlers, who was sort of the top end of the scale in the country, who was at the top end of the scale in which companies. So when I was going into Wrestle Demo, I knew the opportunity it was, and I knew how big of a name he was when I was going into wrestling. So I made sure to learn as much as I possibly could in that match.
Yeah, I get the impression from you, just not just from you or the character you put out anyway, that you're a guy that if you want to know something, you're going to find out everything you possibly can before you're comfortable to actually just dive into it. So that's no surprise when you're saying that. The other match that really jumped out at me was winning a championship, which was the Sunday Slam. It was called Sunday Slam Wrestling Championship, I think it was called. Not so subtle hint on the name. But you won the title in September. So this is not even a year in. I don't know how we are for titles or trophies, how you feel about them, but that's a lot of trust that you're putting on there. I think it was their like kind of secondary shows they were putting on once a month, the Sunday Slam shows. But still, you're coming out with a belt. So what was your reaction to being told and actually getting a title belt?
Well, it was literally just before the match took place. We went into that show with no intention of putting the title on me, but it was actually in Bathgate Gala Day. No, it was called Party in the Park, so it was in Bath, but it's in Bathgate. And we all wrestle a few matches and stuff. And it just so happened that the crowd were really responding to me that day. And I was told before the match, I was going out to wrestle for the title. And I was told, right, we're gonna put the title on you because they're responding quite well to you. So yeah, that it just sort of happened. I wasn't told in advance. It was just sort of, oh, okay, this is happening. And I ended up winning my first title in wrestling. Didn't really have time to prepare or process it. I was just more focused on the match, really.
How's like when it comes? It sounded like you pick up the wrestling quite not easily, but you kind of logically took it all in, and you're able to kind of get it into a way that you're able to do it. When you're in your first year and you're against someone like Damo, and then you win a title quite shortly afterwards, is your thoughts of, oh, this is great, I can do this all day kind of thing? Is was there any kind of early on pitfalls, troubles, or anything that you didn't quite grasp? Was it quite smooth sailing?
I don't know. It's just one of those things where I always strive to be better. And for me, it was always just, okay, I've wrestled Damo. Great honor. I want these matches regularly. I've won a title. Great. This is cool. Take a minute to appreciate it. But I want to just keep on improving, just be the best I possibly can be. So I try not to dwell. It sounds really kind of cliche, but I enjoy those moments at the time. But then when they're done, take a wee second, enjoy them. And then it's just, right, okay, what's next? I guess when I retire, then I can enjoy it a bit more. But for now, it's me. For me, I've always been somebody of, okay, cool, that's happened. But what's next? How can I build on it? How can I improve on it?
So yeah, you're not one to rest on your laurels. You're not like, well, it's fine, I did this way back when. I can sit back and just chill out. You're like, no, what's next? And certainly, moving into 2016, yeah, you certainly picked up quite a few opponents that are now moved on to things like NXT UK or they've appeared all across the world. So you made a Discovery debut. So Reckless Intent would be your home promotion. You made, of course, some appearances in Dundee. But 2016, you made your Discovery debut, though, against Kenny Williams, Lucha DS, and Massimo. So, of course, Kenny is NXT UK, which Discovery had these big, like, four ways elimination matches to kind of introduce all these kind of newer faces for their kind of promotion. What was it like getting the call for Discovery? As you said, that was one of the companies you were very aware of when you were kind of starting out.
I wasn't expecting it at all. It was sort of just came completely out of the blue. And it was another one of those, oh, okay, this is happening. Wasn't expecting to debut for Discovery about a year, I think it was, after I debuted. Wasn't expecting it. And again, it was one of those moments where I knew Alan had put a lot of trust in me to put me on the show at that point. So my main focus was to make sure he didn't regret it and to make sure I proved that I belonged in that match, again, with guys like, for example, like you said, Kenny Williams, who's NXT UK, big name, Massimo, wrestled in Japan and Mexico, massive name, great ability. So I wanted to make sure that I went into that match knowing that I belong in there with those guys, and I was going to do what I could to show that I belonged in there.
And you pretty much established yourself as a name in Discovery after that. You're back most, if not every month, eventually was every month, and you're put into one of the more focal pointed storylines as well, which I think won one of our awards a year for Feud of the Year as well. So it's you're put in a position of trust, and you clearly knocked out of the park, because they wouldn't have brought you back pretty much if you hadn't done it as well. So yeah, 2016 also included matches. You won the Reckless Tent Hardcore Championship, albeit briefly, but you also wrestled at Grado in a triple threat as well. So again, another huge name in Grado. Someone a bit different to yourself as well, because you were the, again, superior separate. You were quite not a serious wrestler, but you're a wrestler, and you're coming in the ring with someone like Grado. How was that kind of putting together a match? Of course, it was a triple threat, Sean Mercer as well. But what was it like putting together a match with Grado?
It was good. I enjoyed it. I mean, there's so many different styles of wrestling. And Grado's style of wrestling is incredible. It's got him to where he was and where he is now. And it was literally just, how can I learn from Grado? How can I learn from someone who's at such a level I want to get to? So it was great just sitting back, listening to the way he put things together, how everything made sense and stuff. So for me, it was a massive learning curve, and it was a great joy to be in the ring with him, to be fair.
We're still about just not even 18 months into your wrestling journey, and you've got these big names, these big opportunities, these big moments. Speaking of the likes of Jackie Polo, being in the ring with him in 2016 as well, which I think when you're talking about being like a wrestler, he's just the epitome of just a proper wrestler as well. So you had that, and of course then you had your match with Michael Chase. I don't know if there was ones with Mikey beforehand, but this is the one I've got noted. You had a few matches with him in Discovery and Reckless. So Michael Chase being the guy that would have been in hand with your training, what was it like getting in the ring with him?
Loved it. Probably my favourite ever opponent, because he trained me not only in the ring, but we trained together in the gym. So we would always push each other. When we were in the gym, in training, in the ring, we would always just push each other to be better. Obviously, Michael Chase was much better than me in the ring. So for me, it was about trying to match his level and try to get as close to his level as I possibly could. Obviously, he got his WWE tryout as well, which shows just how good he was. And it's a shame he's obviously had to retire when he did, but it was great. I mean, some of the best matches I've ever had were with Mikey. And it was just because we were such good friends out of the ring, we could really lay it in the ring. And it was just, there was no holding back, 100 miles an hour. Some of the most fun I've ever had in wrestling, some of the best matches I've ever had in wrestling have been with Mikey.
You're quite closely linked, of course, because the next year then Age of Orion became a thing. So how who approached who to form this team?
it all started where we were booked to wrestle up, I think it was in Peterhead, for United Championship Wrestling, I think they were called. And then we wrestled one tag match there, and then we never sort of tagged again. And then all of a sudden, we were approached to wrestle for ICW. And it was just, we want to use you guys as a tag team. Are you free this Sunday to wrestle the Polos? So we went, and then as soon as we got that call, yep, we can do it. We were in training, practicing tag moves, practicing together. When we were in the gym training together, it was, right, what sort of stuff can we do? And then after sort of that first match at ICW, we just stayed together, really, and it just sort of took off from there. And I'd never been a massive fan of tag team wrestling growing up. I much preferred the singles wrestling. But again, some of the most fun I've had in matches were tagging with Mikey. It was just so easy. And because we got on so well, just in all aspects of life, that chemistry just carried itself on into the ring as a tag team.
It's definitely something when you get offered to wrestle ICW against Polo promotions, what are you going to say? No, I'm the tag guy. No, it's fine. I'll leave it. So you have to do it. And thankfully, it's with someone that you were so close to as well that all kind of worked out perfectly. But no, 2017, again, going through this, I'm trusting Cage Match. This is who I trust for all my information on matches. I know some of them are missing because I think I had all the United Pro results various point. I must still have them somewhere. But yeah, you made debut in Target, Source, United Pro, Respect, ICW. Like 2017, what a year. Was it just like mad that you're popping up in all these places, new crowds? What were your kind of reaction to so many people wanting to see Theo Doros?
To be honest, I didn't even realize it. Now you're saying it is the only time I'm realizing that was sort of all in the same year. Again, at the time, I didn't even notice I was sort of debuting at all these places. It was just, okay, I'm wrestling this weekend. Who am I wrestling? Where am I wrestling? I didn't even notice, because for me, it's always about what's happened has happened. I've learned from it. How can I improve going forward? So, yeah, I guess it was just a case of, okay, I've wrestled at this place. I want to wrestle at these places again. I want to wrestle as much as I possibly can. And I hope that whenever I'm out there performing, no matter what company it's for, I always do my best to show myself in the best possible light, to leave as good an impression as I possibly can. And hopefully I do well enough that companies want to bring me back again. Hopefully I leave an impression on the crowd that they want to see me wrestle again.
Yeah, very much a live in the moment attitude to have. So I mean, it's fine. I haven't got that many more questions that are what you think of this, because it sounds like it is, you just take it in your stride and you just kind of move forward to the next thing, as you've said. But getting opportunities like of course in Discovery at the end of that year, was you were in the ring with like Michael Chase again, Luke King Sharp, and then randomly Lisa Marie Veron. So this is your you've been in the ring with the likes of big names in Scottish wrestling, like your Grados, like your Jackie Polos, like your Demos, but this is Victoria. This is Tara in TNA. This is quite a big name in the world. Anything like that, when you're meeting people that you've maybe watched on the television, do you get any nerves or anything like that when you're in the ring with them? Or again, do you just go, right, this is my job. I'm just going to do what I do.
Yes and no. I mean, I always feel nerves before I'm going out to wrestle, I guess. But not particularly, not in the moment, because we're all there to do a job. We're all there to do the same job. We're all there to put on a show for the fans. We're all there to try and go out and perform the best of our ability. And again, Victoria or Lisa was so nice. She made everyone feel comfortable around her. She wasn't acting like a big superstar, which made everyone just feel a lot more comfortable. And it was just fun. I really enjoyed that match. Again, I was probably more nervous about wanting to make sure that Alan had put his trust in me to go out and wrestle in a match with Lisa. I just wanted to make sure that I proved him right, that I deserve to be in there, and that he's not made a mistake by trusting me with this. So that was more nerve-wracking than who I was actually wrestling, if that makes sense. Because at the end of the day, Alan has been so good to me in my wrestling career so far. And Discovery it's like my second home. So I do always feel a bit of a need to pay back Alan for the opportunities he's given me.
Absolutely. So, I mean, all those kind of opportunities they had, bar maybe Target, because it's a bit further away. What was it like traveling up to places like Peterhead? Are you a fidgety traveler? Do you just get a book and just knuckle down, or do you just get involved in the banner? Because United Pro, it's up my neck of the woods. So it's quite a far distance from down there. I'm in Elgin, so which is like 10 minutes from Bucky. So it's quite a bit of a distance to go for some wrestling. So what was it like traveling all the way up into the sticks here?
The car journeys and stuff, the traveling is a load of fun. It's a load of fun just chatting with the boys and having a bit of banter in the car is good. It's it makes the 4-hour drives seem a lot shorter. So yeah, we just try and enjoy it as much as possible. I'm always the guy who's got his food prepped and stuff as well. So I'll usually be eating in the car, if I'm not driving. So yeah, I'm pretty. I don't mind traveling too much. I enjoy traveling. I enjoy getting about different places and stuff and seeing different parts of the country and seeing different parts of the UK. So I'm always up for a drive, whether it's up north, down south, wherever. It's always good to get about and wrestle in front of different crowds, travel with different people, learn from guys who are more experienced from me. If there's anybody in the cars less experienced than me, if I can help them, and just talking, telling stories about the business. Really, it's good. It's always good fun.
And then be able to pass on some tips about dieting. I'm guessing with your food prep and we'll have you as well. You speak about traveling, we'll park the wrestling chat just for a moment because you're a big fan of Manchester United. I've seen through my research. I was when I was younger, but I gave up on the fake world of football and just concentrated on wrestling instead. So what gathered your love of Man United?
So again, growing up in Cyprus, the Premier League is such a big brand over there. They probably promote it more than they promote the Cypriot League. And my dad was a Man United fan. My brother was a Man United fan. So I just almost got brought up to be a Man United fan. And again, my favourite player when I was growing up, when I was young, was David Beckham. And then they signed Ruud van Nistelrooy. He became my favorite ever player. He's the reason, because he wore number 10 at Man United. He's the reason when I play football, I wear the number 10. He's the reason I've got the number 10 tattooed on my arm. He's the reason I've got number 10 in my Twitter handle and stuff. It's just all my favorite players have played for Man United. David Beckham, Van Nistelrooy, Ronaldo. I've always been a Man United fan. My dad brainwashed me successfully when I was younger. And it was just that's the football I was watching when I was growing up. They were the best team as well, which helped. And obviously with me sort of being the superior Cypriot, I hate losing, so I couldn't support a team that loses a lot. I'm a bit of a I'll stick with United for now. That I'll be a United fan for life. But especially growing up, being the horrific loser I was, I wasn't going to support a team that lost a lot.
I remember in my youth when I was supporting them. I watched the 1999 Champions League final. I was in tears because I thought they were going to lose. Then I was in tears because they won. And then I remember it was way in the future. I think it was 2003 because they had the white Vodafone kit, and it was against Vasco da Gama. I think it was a Champions League possibly, and they got absolutely hammered. And I was 13, bawling my eyes out, going, they can't lose that much. They can't, because it was like, I think 3-1. I think it ended like that. And it was, they got absolutely just demolished. Fabian Barthez had a horrific game. It's a weird, like, I don't know how I end up, I think my mates supported Man United. And I was like, all right, if you are, I'll trust you. Let's go with that then. But no, it's it's from what I've read and seen, it's not so much the glory days anymore.
Far from it. But we've got Ronaldo back, so who knows? Hopefully, he can work some form of magic and drag us to a trophy this year.
Fingers crossed. But I noticed that, of course, Damo as well is a big Man United fan. So was that something you kind of linked early on, that you were able to pass also wrestling tips and hints, but you also had this kind of bond about Man United as well? Because I suppose wrestlers don't always want to speak about wrestling. That's kind of want to avoid it as at some point. So is that your kind of thing that you could have to speak about to people, just about football?
Yeah, and I remember when I first met Damo, he said at the time there wasn't many football fans in wrestling. I think that's slowly changing now. But me and him spoke about Man United quite a lot. We actually went to a couple games together as well, and it was a good way to bond. Again, traveling down in the car with Damo to Manchester, I was able, we spoke about football and stuff, but we did speak a bit about wrestling, so I was able to learn from him there. But I think I even bumped into him at a Man United game as well, which was bizarre, where we were both sat in the same sort of block. We hadn't traveled down together, but we were both in the same block, which was a bit strange. But yeah, me and Damo, we were able to bond over Man United, over football in general. And it was good at the last Discovery show. Obviously, it was Damo's return to Discovery. And Man United were playing Chelsea, so it was good to be able to sit in the back after both of our matches. We were able to sit in the back and watch the second half of the Man United-Chelsea game together. And it was good. It was good, again, because we were able to bond over United, and before obviously he went to WWE, and when he was back, it's nice to have somebody who's a Man United fan in the changing room with you.
Yeah, from what I've found when speaking to people so far, that seems to be a lot of wrestlers like things like D&D and anime, and I'm just as lost about that than I am about football. At least football I knew when I was younger. I can kind of force my way through a conversation about it, but no, anything else, I'm just like, nah, you're just mentioning things like dice, and I'm like, okay, all right, cool, I'll just move on. So yeah, back to the wrestling chat. 2018, again, another big year, which you're going to just kind of go, yeah, just a year. But you ended up in the Drew Galloway Invitational. So that was when, of course, for those that are unaware, it brought three schools together and had two wild cards. So I had three schools, and then the wild cards were Damien from WrestleZone, and you from Reckless 10. So was like, again, I think it was Red Lightning who was kind of organizing all that kind of thing, or Rudo Lightning, he's known by now. So did you get the call? Were you put forward? How did you end up getting involved with the Drew Galloway Invitational?
So Red came up to me. Again, me and Mikey were tagging at ICW in one of the Edinburgh shows. It was me and Mikey against Ashton Smith and Rampage. So we were in Edinburgh for that. I think it was in Potter Row, I think it was. So it was before that match where Red came up to me and he spoke to me. He said, we're doing the Drew Galloway Invitational this year, and we want you to be one of the wild cards. Are you up for it? And obviously I thought, this is really cool. And again, I just wanted to do my school proud, do my trainers proud and everything. So I jumped at the chance. And it wasn't something I was expecting at all. So to get that call, to get asked to do it, was pretty cool, and it was something I was quite proud of at the time. And then again, it was just how can I make sure that when I go there, I'm doing myself proud, doing my trainers proud, and just taking this opportunity to showcase that, you know, that Reckless Intent produces guys who are just as good as anyone in the country.
There was a time, very briefly, that of course Reckless had a partnership with another company, and it kind of had a little bit of a briefly had a little bit of a stink on them because of the partnership with the particular company. So it was nice to see guys from Reckless being everywhere, just getting out ICW, getting out to to source or whatever. So it goes to show that even if you start rubbing shoulders with some maybe questionable people, it's not be all and end all, as long as you can keep proving your worth, which is what you've been doing. You've just been keep proving that you deserve to be on shows and deserve to be on the card and being booked again.
I was gonna say, I think Mikey has a lot to do with that in the sense that he made the effort to go out and make relationships with guys like Alan at Discovery and get a good relationship with him, and then go and make friends with the guys at Source and make sure that he was on a good relationship with them. And then obviously, guys, he got his break at ICW and had a good relationship with the people running that, and he just got himself in everywhere and made sure that everybody knew, okay, Mikey, not only is he an incredible wrestler, he's a good coach and he's got good morals, he's a good guy. So we know that if he's who the guys at Reckless are learning from, then we know that they'll have similar morals, similar standards, and be just, you know, obviously not just as good as Mikey, but they'll be good enough. So he definitely went out his way to build relationships with the right people and make sure that Reckless was seen in the light it deserves to be seen in. And then the guys who have taken over now have made sure to carry on that work, kept the relationships, kept good relationships with good people, and make sure, again, that Reckless is in a good light, because it's an incredible company. Good morals, always takes care of everyone that steps through the door. So I'm just glad it's starting to get the recognition it deserves.
Absolutely. I spoke to Mikey in the past, way back when I was like thinking about doing podcasts like 5 years ago, and he's got that moral center, and he's went out and made these relationships because he was in a company that kind of said he was blacklisted, said he wouldn't make it anywhere, he wouldn't do anything. Then there he is on WWE TV helping Samoa Joe to the back on Raw, you know. So it's like he's clearly got that moral center that went, no, I'm going to make my friends, I'm going to make sure that I do it the right way, and he did, and he's produced talent like yourself, and of course, like you're saying, he's built that trust up. If a promoter went up to him and went, oh, who do you recommend to be on the show, and you'll put your name forward, you can take his word as gospel. He wouldn't put you forward if he didn't think you were prepared to do it, kind of thing as well.
Yeah, totally. And that's something that he worked hard to get to that level of himself. He put himself out there, built the bridges, and then proved himself as a coach, proved himself as a wrestler. And then the guys that have, like I said, the guys that have taken over from him, it's been seamless. The ball's just kept rolling, and they're still helping produce some great talent coming out with Reckless.
So 2018, of course, United Pro Wrestling, you won their championship. You're the first UPW champion. I think that's pretty much when I ended up bumping into you at one of the Bucky shows. It was interesting because I had to watch my brother who's got autism, learned disabilities. I was like, we'll get a picture with you. I was thinking you would come out to meet him because I didn't know if he would actually get in the ring. But I've never witnessed and never seen again him getting into a wrestling ring. And it was quite emotional for a moment because I was like, I didn't think Dan would do this. There he is, second rope, like a pro, slipping into the ring and getting back out again. That's just a wee moment for me. But no, thank you for just being nice at that show. That's the least I expect, I suppose. But it was quite nice to be part of that little moment to get a picture with yourself, with the title. But like I say, you're not that big on titles as the moment. You take it and then you keep going, you give them that trust. But yeah, what was it? What was it? I've already asked the travel one. I'll ignore that. I'll move on. Next question. So 2018 kind of had the I've got myself a fluster because I started speaking with my brother. That's very weird. December, kind of Age of Orion became tag team champions, and then you won the Reckless Intent heavyweight championship as well. So you've completed Reckless Intent. So
I've still got the UK title to win. So I've still got one title left to win at Reckless, and that's yeah, I want to win that. I want to win that. That's still on the radar.
But anyway, heavyweight championship then? That's pretty big then. You started in 2015 and then what was that? 4 years, 3 years later, 4 years later, 2019, you're now holding the big belt as well. So was that, did you feel accomplished? Like, yeah, I mean, you haven't got the UK title yet, but in a way you're still top of the heap. You've worked your way all the way up to the top of Reckless Intent. Was that just, was that a defining moment for you? You're just like, yeah, that's, I've accomplished something by doing that.
That was, yeah, that was a very cool moment. That was one where I did take a minute to just, when I was in the ring after winning it, I took a minute to just almost just really, really soak it in, enjoy it. It was, when I was told I was winning the title, it was a really cool moment. Because obviously it's the place I trained, I still remember turning up to my first Reckless show to help out and seeing the champion at the time was Scott Rennick. I remember seeing him and just thinking, one day I want to be Reckless Intent champion. If I can do that, I'll be happy. And just the way he carried himself as a champion, I thought he does it well. He brings a sense of pride to the role and stuff. So, and Scott Rennick as well was the first person to ever train me, took my first ever training session. So he was champion at the time. So when I was told I was winning the title, my mind instantly thought to Scott, wanted to thank him for helping me get to where I was, because if he hadn't made that first session as enjoyable, I don't know if I would have stuck to it. And I enjoyed the moment, enjoyed winning the title. And I won the challenge of representing the company as champion in the proper way, not only in the ring, but outside the ring as well. How I conduct myself on, for example, on social media, how I conduct myself just in day-to-day life, and then go out there and put on the best match I possibly can for the fans, for everybody really. And just, again, to prove that the people have trusted me to represent Reckless Intent as champion, that they've made the right decision, that I'm gonna help try and bring this company up as much as I possibly can, have the best matches I possibly can, get people talking about the company as much as I possibly can, and just do what I can to make them proud of me as champion, and just repay them for giving me the opportunity to represent the company.
The professional, in the word professional wrestler kind of thing, just put it all together and be the professional. Not long after that, though, Mikey retired. So he retired with the actual belt that you won as well. He retired with it. What was it like being part of his? Were you his last opponent, or was it Joe Hendry? I can't remember. I didn't write it down. But so you were part of his last match, though. So you're part of the last show he was on. So it was an emotional day. Did you know beforehand that that was definitely him done, or was there any jitters that you thought that he might maybe have a couple more before it was all said and done? His last match was Discovery with MVP.
Yeah. So right. His last match was Discovery with MVP, and I was his second last match, obviously, the day before. I'd been told maybe a month or two before that I was going to be Mikey's last opponent at Reckless. And to be honest with you, I have never, ever been more nervous before a match than I was before that one. More so because I wanted to go out there and I wanted Mikey to enjoy his last match. I wanted him to go out and have as good of a send-off as he possibly could. I just wanted to go out there and, again, one, have let him enjoy that moment, enjoy his match as much as he possibly could, and two, again, just show him, because he picked me, he wanted me to be his last opponent at Reckless. So I wanted to prove to him, you've made the right choice in picking me as being your last opponent. You've trained me as well as you possibly could have, and I wanted to almost show him that the training you've done for me has worked. Almost like the proof is in the pudding, that look, you have trained so many guys to get to a certain level, and I want to show you how good the guys you've trained are. I want you to go out and enjoy this last match as much as you possibly can, and just So I was incredibly nervous about if I mess up, then it might take away from his last match or whatever. And I remember in the match, it was about a minute in where I can't remember what happened. I don't even know how it happened, but I ended up rolling my knee the complete wrong way. And it just, the pain that shot up through it, I was just like, oh, okay. I can't really put any weight on my knee, but we've literally just started a 20 minute match. So, and there was, like, even if my leg was falling off, I still would have fought through to give Mikey the match he deserved. So when that match was done and seeing how much he enjoyed it, it was pretty cool. It was a good night. It was probably the most important match I'll ever wrestle in my life.
Yeah, that's a nice wee point for him to end. And of course, he got his match with MVP and the next night. So the title, of course, was gone. You're still the champion. I noticed that they had like an interim belt, which was just a very basic title belt. As soon as I saw it, I was like, I really hope that's not the belt that they continue with, because it was awful. But you got a big gold belt instead. That's how it's the Reckless Intent Championship is now. So when you started watching back in 2003, then it would have been a Triple H probably hoarded that belt to no end. Yeah. So to be given a big gold belt, was that kind of like, this is kind of harken back to your childhood that you got to hold the big gold belt yourself, or what were your thoughts on that?
At the time, I thought it was pretty cool. Again, growing up, I liked the big gold belt. I thought it was a really nice belt. But it was only sort of through when things locked down, I started watching a lot of old stuff, and seeing Flair with the big gold belt. Then it was more sort of through lockdown that seeing the big gold belt in like the early WCW days and stuff. That's when I got a much more of an appreciation for it. So it was after I already had the belt, watching, like, obviously Flair synonymous with it, watching Flair defend the belt and stuff, that's when I was like, oh, this is actually really, really cool. So I already had it, and then my affection for it grew after I already had it, just watching every single night. I'd watch wrestling with Darren Goss. We would just call each other and watch wrestling throughout lockdown. And just watching all these old guys who I'd never really seen much of, I was able to learn new stuff from them, but watching them wrestle and compete for the big gold belt was really, really cool. And it made me appreciate what I had that little bit more.
Is there anyone in particular that Darren kind of pointed out that you have to watch these particular people? This will add to your game, kind of thing. Was there anyone that you thought, well, that you never heard of before, that caught your eye, that was just like, yes, I need more of that guy in my life?
Not so much anyone that I'd never heard of, but we watched a lot of stuff. And I remember it all started because I had never watched WrestleMania's one up until I think it was 13. And then obviously we got told you're going into a 3-week lockdown. So we thought, well, we'll try and see if we can watch WrestleMania's 1 to 13 in this 3 weeks. And then obviously it ended up being a little bit longer than 3 weeks. So we ended up watching a lot. And it was guys who I'd heard of, guys who I knew were a big deal in wrestling, but I'd never actually watched. So the main ones were watching a lot of Flair's older stuff, a lot of Bret Hart, a lot of Macho Man Randy Savage, Ricky Steamboat. It was watching those guys who I knew who they were and I knew they were a big deal, but I'd never actually watched too much of them. So it was a case of watching them and studying them and just seeing what they do, how they do it, how they made everything make sense and stuff. And it just, that's who I was studying. That's how I spent my lockdown, just essentially just training and then watching wrestling. That's pretty much what I did every single day, was work out and watch wrestling. So and right the way through lockdown, it lit a fire under me watching these guys, and it made me, again, I knew I couldn't get into a wrestling ring. So my mentality was, okay, I can't get into a ring. how can I improve? How can I get myself better? So when we are able to wrestle again, I won't be the same wrestler I was when everything shut. I still want to improve. I still want to use this time to get better at things. So I would practice my promos. I would watch guys who I'd never seen before, watch guys who I knew were the best at the time, see what they did. How can I do what they're doing? How can I bring that style, make it a bit more modern, tweak it a little bit, and then add my own spin on things. So I made sure to use all the extra time we had throughout lockdown to improve myself as a wrestler as well. I didn't want to just rest on my laurels. I didn't want to go back and just be the same Theo Doros I'd always been. I wanted to change up and come back completely new, completely fresh, and better than I was when things shut down.
You kind of perfect point then, because of course that lockdown was the next thing I've got noted down, because on this little timeline I've got. Yeah. So that's pretty much what you did. You just watched wrestling and trained as much as you could. That's pretty much what I think most of us did. Well, no, I didn't train. I watched wrestling. That was it. I should clarify that. I did no training. The only thing I was walking towards was the fridge and then back to my seat. So how were you, of course, watching wrestling with Darren over the phone, of course, because he's down in Wales. Was that kind of like your social time? Was there Zoom calls? Was there Zoom training that you were taking part in or anything like that? Or was it just wrestling training?
Just wrestling training, really. I did I did one of the Zoom training sessions with Lance Storm. But yeah, it was mainly just watching wrestling. We spoke on the phone, broke the matches down, chatted about them between us, and just me throwing ideas at him, saying, do you think this would work? Do you think that would work? And just having somebody to bounce the ideas off of, obviously, because it's a bit difficult, because when there is no wrestling, it's hard to be like, well, I'm going to try this and see if it sticks. Try this and see if the crowd responds. So it was just a case of, I had so many ideas, but I couldn't try them because obviously there was no wrestling, and I was just itching to get back to it, itching to put everything into practice. So yeah, it was just a case of watching as much wrestling, learning as much as I physically could throughout lockdown while everything was shut, and just essentially just having ideas, coming up with so many ideas in my head for different promotions, for different companies. If I can work here, what would my angle be? Where can I take myself? How can I portray myself in different ways across Scotland, across wrestling, across the UK?
Well, you've read my mind how we're going to move on to the segue into the next bit in 2020, closed-door shows. So ICW, of course, came back, but they're no crowd at all. They were doing closed-door tapings. And yeah, ended up on the WWE Network. So that's pretty cool. How were you approached? When were you approached to take part in these shows? Were your thoughts of having to watch some of these Thunderdome shows so you can get a feel how to wrestle in front of no crowd? What was your kind of process into getting into that?
So again, it was Scott Reed that messaged me asking me if I was free to do the tapings. So obviously I had nothing on. So I was I went and did the tapings, and it was just, again, I wanted to go there, and I'd never wrestled at ICW as a singles wrestler. So I wanted to go in, and I knew I was getting an opportunity, and I wanted to go in again and show Scott Reed, Mark Dallas, the guys who brought me in, you're right to be bringing me in. I don't want to come to ICW just to be another name who's filling up a slot in the closed door tapings. I want to be a player here. I want to show that I belong here in the biggest company in the UK, if not Europe. I wanted to show I belong here. And again, you guys have given me an opportunity here, and I want to take it with both hands. I want to run with it. And I want to show you guys you've made the right decision. And I didn't even really think too much about the behind closed door thing. It was just, it's one of those ones where it's hard to learn, how to wrestle in front of no crowd, because it's just, it's such an artificial environment. But I went there and it was just a completely new experience for me, wrestling in front of no crowd. And it was just one where I thought, again, it's just sink or swim. You just, you can't really prepare for it. And it was comforting because nobody else, everyone was in the same boat. Nobody else had really any experience of not wrestling in front of a crowd. Nobody had done it before. So it's not as if I was going in at a disadvantage or an advantage over anybody else. We were all in the same boat, sort of thinking, right, well, we'll just go and see what happens and see how it is. There's no real other option. You can't have a crowd in there. And it's not as if we could even bring in other people to fill the venue out, because obviously there was only a certain amount of people who could be in the building. And obviously, like, ICW took every precaution they possibly could. It was very professionally run. Obviously, it started before we had lap flows and stuff. So it was all hand sanitizer, masks, everything. The ring was disinfected, so they made sure everything was as safe on their part. So it was quite comforting going in, knowing everything was okay, and just doing what we could, doing our best. And it was very strange, very, very strange to wrestle in front of no people.
And did you approach them with this? You said you were thinking of all these character things you could do when you come back. Did you approach them with this traditional wrestling aficionado that wanted to make it all proper rules again in ICW? Was that yourself, or was that a kind of pool effort between yourself and Scott Reed and to get this character formed?
So the character was more so, it's tough to say because they had ideas obviously where they wanted to go with the rules. I had my ideas where I wanted to go with my character and stuff, and they've been brilliant. Every idea I've pitched to them, they've accepted, and they've helped change direction. And without sort of saying no, you can't do this, it's been a case of, we like that idea, this is where we want to go with it, so we'll take it down this direction. So they've been absolutely fantastic with that. And they've trusted me again, wrestling guys like Doug Williams, to have that opportunity was great. They've been fantastic with me. It's some of the most fun I have with wrestling, to be honest. And the whole, when I grew up, I didn't like any of the hardcore style of wrestling. I've never been into that. Not a fan of ECW, not a fan of hardcore matches and stuff. So for me, being able to wrestle in traditional wrestling rules was perfect, really, to be honest with you.
Also, to be the guy that kind of stops some of the hardcore activity in ICW is not from a standpoint of going, you didn't like ECW, but being the guy that has done this as well, it's like, yeah, I'm showing you what wrestling I like, you're gonna like it too, kind of thing, I suppose, in the whole character's mindset of it. So what's it like being on the WWE Network, though? I mean, I suppose for yourself, you're still just doing what you're doing, but the fact that someone can go on to WWE.com, WWENetwork.com, put in THE, they'll be like The Miz, The Undertaker, Theo Doros.
Again, it's I one of the main reasons I like being on the WWE Network is it's an easy way for me to watch my matches back and critique myself. So that's the biggest plus for me, I guess. But it's something that the first night I was on the WWE Network was really cool. Being able to go on to the WWE Network, search my name and see my face crop up was a bit of a surreal moment. But now it's just, okay, I'm on the WWE Network, cool. But that I'm on there now. I want to move forward. I want to help. I want to help myself grow. I want to help promote ICW on the WWE Network as much as possible. How can I get more eyes on ICW? How can I get more eyes on the product they're putting out, because again, they through the whole lockdown, we were doing tapings and stuff. They put a lot of effort into making the tapings as safe as possible for us, so we can go out and produce this content. And we've done all that for the fans to put it on the network and stuff. So it's cool being on there, but again, it's more just right now we're on there. How do we make sure that more people are seeing ICW on the network and stuff? So it's cool being on there, but for me, it's now about I want to do what I can to help bring ICW up as much as possible on the network and stuff.
So yeah, like pay back their hospitality to get you on there. Now you're like, yes, I'll do what I can, but like, you know, NXT UK is the next thing I could be on. Let's see what I can do here and then work towards that. And then there's NXT and then Raw. And then before you know it, I mean, in 5 years, you've accomplished all of this. There's no question that, say, another 2-3, you could be on one of the main WWE shows on the network, which is not, but with your attitude and your drive, is not impossible, which is kind of mind blowing when you think that you would have you started watching wrestling in Cyprus, and there's the now you're on the WWE network, and there's all the opportunity in the world to be in the biggest company in the world as well. So it's wrestling's just such a small, close knit world now. When we started watching back in our youth, it was like you didn't think you'd ever be able to do these things, and here we are, 2022.
Even when I started wrestling, to think that if somebody had said to me when I started wrestling that, oh, you'll be on the WWE Network, I would have laughed at them. But like you were saying there, obviously, there's NXT UK, NXT and all this. For me now, it would be as cool as it would be to be on NXT UK, to be on NXT. Is it a goal? Yeah, it is. But the main thing for me just now, the only thing I'm focusing on is trying to pay back to the three main companies who have put a lot of trust in me and they've given me the most opportunities in Reckless, Discovery and ICW. And they're the three companies who have really sort of got behind me and supported me and given me the platform to wrestle. Wrestle great opponents, have some of the best experiences of my life, that now for me, I just want to help elevate them, give back to them, and any wrestling company that puts a little bit of faith in me by giving me a spot on the show, I want to try and pay back to them. And just if they're giving me a spot on the show, they're putting a little bit of trust in me, I want to do what I can to pay back that trust tenfold. I'll never complain about who I'm wrestling, I'll never complain about what I get asked to do, because I just enjoy getting to do what I do. So if anybody asks me to do something, I'll do it with a smile on my face, and I'll ask them how they want me to do it.
And that trust, obviously, payback and Discovery, it was October 17th, I think, their first show back, Disco is back. You're in the main event against, Joe Hendry, just a star at the time in Ring of Honor across the world. Quite a big deal. A Commonwealth champion, you know, just these little things. You're in the main event of their first show back. Clearly you've worked that trust to get that spot. But what was it like getting in front of a crowd for the first time in however many months to actually hear a roar of the crowd again?
Really cool. Really cool. Again, being trusted to main event the first Discovery show back was something, again, I can only thank Alan for. He gave me that opportunity. I'd like to think I delivered. Obviously, I didn't quite come away with the Y Division title, but it was surreal being able to main event that show. Like I said to you, Discovery means a lot to me. So being able to go out there and perform in front of a crowd, a Discovery for the first time. We'd done a couple of shows with ICW in front of crowds since then, but going out and wrestling in the main event in front of a crowd for the first time in nearly 2 years was really cool. And getting to go out there with somebody as good as Joe, you know, it was just he's on at such a high level, where again, getting to wrestle him, getting to learn from him was an invaluable experience, and it gave me the taste of wrestling in the main event for Discovery, and it makes me want to do it again. To be honest with you, for me, I've main evented Discovery once, cool, but now I want to get there again and stay there.
And one of the other big matches that you had before we kind of wrap up the other this next wrestling section is with Ravy Davey, of course, at the Barrowlands for ICW. He did send in a question, which was just simply why are you a dafty? So, but wrestling at the Barrowlands, I guess it's going to be a cool experience. You seem to be the most humblest wrestler I've ever spoken to, who's just like, yeah, this was cool. Next thing, there we go. But so what was like Barrowlands, Ravy Davey? Why are you a dafty?
probably a dafty for getting chased by him around the Barrowlands for 20 minutes. No, wrestling at the Barrowlands was... I didn't grow up here, and one thing I'm not a fan of is music. I'm not a big music listener. I'll listen to bits and pieces pretty much only when I'm in the gym, really. But I'm not a massive music fan. So the first time I stepped foot in the Barrowlands was to wrestle. I'd never been to see any bands or anything there. But both of my, two of my uncles both play in bands. One of them's played in Vegas, and when I told them, oh, I'm wrestling at the Barrowlands, both of them were really envious of me, especially the one who had played in Vegas, who had said, oh, that's my dream venue. And I'm sitting there going, you've played in Vegas. And so that's when I realized how big a deal it was, and it was just, again, it was really cool just to be in there and be in such a venue. And when I walked in, you could almost feel the history. It was like, okay, yeah, this is a great venue. You can tell it means a lot to people. You can tell you can tell a lot of things have happened there. So again, having the opportunity to wrestle there was really cool. And again, it's something that I'm really thankful to ICW for giving me that opportunity to wrestle there. And to wrestle, wrestle, to be able to fight, it was a Glasgow street fight, I guess, or to be able to fight Davey there was, and that was obviously where the rules changed and stuff, so be able to do that there was a pretty cool moment. And it was, again, it was one where I'm like, I've wrestled in this venue, it's amazing, but I don't want this to be the last time I wrestle in a venue like this.
Absolutely. I mean, I would ask what your hopes and dreams are for the future, but like I said, I think we've already established that just everything, and you'll work to get there as well. We ask a couple silly questions to all of our guests here. It's been a couple of weeks since I've had to ask it, because I've had so many returning guests, but the first one is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
I was actually asked this 2 days ago, believe it or not. It's a T-Rex.
Nice and simple. That's fine. That's how I like it. And the other question we asked, who asked you that question?
It was my partner.
I thought it was going to be Kevin Williams, because he started this question way back in the first couple of episodes, and I've just stole it from him. So sorry, Kev. I've even got merchandise now with dinosaurs on it. So
amazing.
I've lifted it entirely from him. But unfortunately, I don't sell any, so he's not getting any cut. So the question we ask people is, what would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
I'm gonna go for the cow.
So I just, there's gut feeling.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fine. Again, another question we've lifted. I think it was Looking Sharp that we've stolen that from. I've just kept it. The other one that I think I'm trying to establish is favorite McFlurry. From Stone Malone, but I can't see you being a McFlurry kind of guy.
I can't even tell you the last time I had the McFlurry from me. Again, not because it's McDonald's, but I'm not a massive ice cream fan. But if I was saying my favorite McFlurry, is probably the special edition Malteser one they do.
That is a great choice. That is a fantastic choice. Wow, right. That's a lot to think on there. I'm now hungry. So when it comes to wrestling, though, like I said, we've discussed that you're just wanting to work hard and get there. But if there was a chance, say, is there a dream venue that you'd want to wrestle in? Would it be Old Trafford? Would, if you had the chance to wrestle there, would that be like the pinnacle of your life to wrestle there?
Again, I don't really know. for me, I've had some of the best experience of my life in wrestling. Again, if you ask me when I started wrestling, what I would like to achieve, I've accomplished all of that already, mm-hmm. because I just didn't know how far I could go with wrestling. From when I started it as just a hobby I would do every now and then. I didn't expect it to be this big of a part of my life. So I don't actually have sort of any set goals in mind, I would say. And it's just one where I just want to work as hard and be the best wrestler I possibly can be. So when I do end my career, when I do stop wrestling, I won't ever be like, oh, I wish I'd done this, I wish I'd done that. My main goal, I guess, is to leave wrestling with no regrets.
That's a good way to end it. Right, so before we end it, I want to ask about your moveset just for a second, because, of course, you're a big fan of The Rock. I think you've got a rock bottom, or Yurangi as one of your favorite moves. How did the Superman punch come into the moveset?
We were doing a drill and training in a seminar, and it was to do with running forearms, and the person I was paired up with was taller than me, so I would have to jump into the forearm, and then someone just said, that looks really cool, so I practiced it, and then it eventually just became the Superman punch, and it just sort of stayed, although I don't tend to use it as much just now. It was just because I was trying to punch someone who was taller than me. So I'd had to jump.
Strange things have happened. I think Drew McIntyre said the Claymore kick was just because his leather jeans were too tight, and he ended up just doing that and trying to do a big boot. So stranger things do happen. So we'll finish up with just advice that you want to give to, I've already mentioned the match with Joe Hendry. I was panicking thinking I hadn't. If there's any advice, if you go back, I've got the opinion and got the impression that you're just very humble. You're just happy just to keep working hard and getting these opportunities and earning them. But if you can go back to that first training session, look to yourself and go, right, this is what you should know, what's coming up kind of thing. Is there any advice you would give yourself or to anyone that's planning to be involved in pro wrestling?
It's a bit of advice Bobby Lashley actually gave me. And when I saw him at Body Power a few years ago, it was just enjoy it and don't take yourself too seriously. Take what you do seriously, but don't take yourself too seriously, and just enjoy everything you do. And that's it, really. I mean, I'm lucky enough that the amount of positive experiences I've had in wrestling ridiculously outweigh the negatives. I can probably count the negative experiences on one hand. Wrestling has given me some of the best nights of my life. It's given me some of the best friends I'll ever have. It would literally just be enjoy the ride and just stick at it, enjoy the ride, and it'll be worth it.
Well, I think that's a good place to kind of close off then. So where can people find you on social media if they're wanting to find out more about Theo Doros?
So on Twitter, I am Theo10Doros. And I think it's the same on Facebook again. On Facebook it is as well, just Theo Doros. And on Instagram, it's Theo10Doros as well.
Perfect. Well, again, thank you very much for joining me today.
Thanks for having me.